will come here. Why? Like from the concept of linear algebra, I am asking a simple, very simple kind of question that in linear algebra, you might have already seen a linear system. How we write it? We write it, that means it is a collection of linear equations we write in matrix and vector product form. This is the throughout in linear algebra, you might have seen this. This one is the ultimate aim to solve in a various way and to understand the intrinsic thing about y equal to ax, how we can understand about this. So simply one question I am asking about this. This we simply call it linear system. You may say this linear system everywhere in your branch, electronics and communication, you can see everywhere. It may represent any kind of model. You can see in control theory, you can see in system identification, you can see in image processing, you can see in various that signal processing, various kind of thing. You can see in machine learning. Everywhere you will see this kind of linear system. Simply you can call it linear system, and later we will term it as a linear model as well. So linear model, we are seeing more broader perspective from the learning problem. Okay, so you can also say that linear model. So if I ask y equal to ax, definitely it is a linear system. Just try to answer from the math 3, that linear algebra. What is the solution space of this system? Anyone? Simply here, what are the given thing you need to know? So what are the given thing you are having? So here simply y we are calling it response, and A we are calling it coefficient matrix or design matrix. More general name of A is design matrix. These two would be given to you. It would be known to you. What is unknown to you? X is unknown to you. So you have to find X. X may have different various notation. So here only two things are unknown, known, Y and A. So Y is having a name that we are calling it response vector. You can say that it is a vector, response vector. That one is coming from some m-dimensional Euclidean space. We denote it by Rm. Rm. And what is A? A, we simply, you can say that coefficient matrix, but more generic name is design matrix. If you are from EC, always term it as a design matrix. Definitely it is a matrix. And what would be the size of this matrix? Not M by N, it would be M by N. M is the number of measurement or sample size, what we call it. If you try to go from the learning problem perspective, M we are calling it number of measurement or number of equations. N is dimension or number of parameter or dimension of X. Also you can say that X is the unknown that we want to learn. X is unknown. We don't know X. That we have to find or we have to estimate if the system is consistent. Now tell me, what is the solution space? Suppose the system, so definitely there would be two criteria you will have. You will say either the system is solvable or not solvable. So you are having two criteria about this linear system. Either you will say it is solvable, or that means system, linear system is consistent. You are talking about consistent, that means it is a solvable system, and it is having a solve either one solution or infinitely many solution. There are two criteria here you are coming to see. You say that it is consistent, that means definitely it is solvable or it is not solvable. That not solvable, we are saying that inconsistent. Okay, everything must be clear like this way. If you have already gone through that linear algebra class, inconsistent. Okay, inconsistent, simply we say that. We say then this system is Consistent, what does it mean? Simply we say that this system is solvable. So if solvable, there are two situations will come here. One will be either will be unique solution or will be infinitely many solution. There are two situations or infinitely many solution. Infinitely many solution, simply you say that you are having a solution of space. Infinitely many solution. Okay, tell me if there is a situation that there are infinitely many solution, how we can get the solution of space? Anyone? How we can get solution of space? So it is all about how much you know about the design matrix, that matrix. How much you know? So throughout linear algebra, you might have the idea how much you know about A. So that throughout, in every eigenvalue decomposition, can you talk about eigenvalue decomposition here? Matrix, I have taken it M by M. Then is it possible to talk about eigenvalue decomposition of this matrix? Is it possible or not? When we are saying that it is M by N matrix, then this here, it generally this design matrix is, we are saying that it is a rectangular matrix. So here I am not saying that it is N by N matrix. So when you talk about eigenvalue decomposition, we always proceed with a square matrix. That means sample size and that number of that dimension must be matches. Both must be same. Then we talk about eigenvalue decomposition. If such information is not given here, how you can proceed with? Any idea? And even you should not go directly to decomposition problem right now. So just talk it from just chapter 2 or something like that, module 2 kind of things. Even that when we talk about decomposition, decomposition is really what did decomposition process it's talk about. It is directly talking about solution process. That computational ability is provided by decomposition process. So that one is part of computational what capacity of linear algebra. Right now I'm just talking about geometrical part of linear algebra. That one is dealing with a linear system. Then if I say that geometrically how you can say that how you can find the solution of space of this system? Simply from the geometrical part. Suppose this one is solvable. So that's why from here itself you can talk about consistent, in case of consistent, from the coefficient matrix or design matrix itself, how you can say that this is, how we can, what would be the solution of space? How we can visualize the solution of space by just observing this design matrix? Anyone? Again, you are going to same situation that actually what we call it a square matrix. Don't worry about that. Is simply when I am saying that it is this system is consistent, that means this one is solvable. Then what you do, you can talk about four fundamental subspaces of this design matrix. What are those four fundamental subspaces? Column space, row space, null space, left null space. So just find null space of this matrix. Have you gone through null space of this matrix? Have you gone through all those four fundamental subspaces? Anyone? It is just part of module 2. First you are studying linear system. After that you are studying vector subspaces. There you will come across to see all four types of fundamental subspaces of a matrix. Have you gone through or not? Anyone? Be honest. Why you are talking about eigenvalue? It is, there is no essential to talk about right now eigenvalue. Eigenvalue that will come later. If you are going through eigenvalue, I'm talking about that one is computational framework. I'm talking about from the geometrical perspective. So here just these four fundamental subspaces are very easy to visualize. This null space, column space, then row space generally happens to be null column space of A transpose, and left null space happens to be null space of A transpose. These are the four fundamental subspaces, and these are having very interesting kind of property. You can say that this null space is perpendicular to this one, perpendicular to row space, and this column space is perpendicular to left null space, perpendicular to left. So these are having, so null space and row space in together, they bring decomposition of domain space. So A is a matrix, so definitely A defines a linear transformation from Rm to Rn. It is defining linear transformation from Rm to Rn. So that's where domain would be this Rm, m dimensional, sorry, it would be Rn to Rn. Yes. Rn to. So here domain space would be n dimensional Euclidean space. Okay. Just think over it. Have you seen all these or not? Just rephrase all these, otherwise I have already provided a YouTube link for my course that I had taken for linear algebra. You can go through that, and just understanding of all these are very much essential. So simply, if I talk about a 2 by 2 matrix, like if I am taking it 1 by 2 and 2 by 4, and geometrically visualize that, what would be the column space of this one? Can you visualize what would be column space, what would be null space, and what would be definitely this is a matrix from R2 to R2. Domain is also a 2-dimensional Euclidean space, and what we call it codomain is also 2-dimensional Euclidean space. So geometrically, if you are willing to visualize, then you can easily visualize. So 2-dimensional space, it is coming, it is having just two direction. Why we are saying 2-dimensional space? That a space is having just two direction, that's why we are saying 2-dimensional space. So anyone say that what would be the column space? How you can, anyone, what would be the column space, and what would be the row space? Suppose this one is your domain, I am writing it here, D equal domain of the this matrix R2, and this one is the codomain CD. Okay, where you will observe column space? Where you will observe column space? Anyone? Column space is just linear combination of columns. Simply you say that it is a linear combination of columns. So how many columns you observe here? This one you can call it first column, this one is the second column, plus alpha to C2, and here alpha 1 and alpha 2 happens to be a scalar, it will keep on taking value from real number. Okay, so simply it is talking about column space. So where you will visualize column space is domain and codomain. And what would be the direction? So it is column space. Remember that. Just don't forget about all computational thing. I always say that see the geometry. Don't go directly jump to eigenvalue, eigen kind of thing. That will come later. That one is part of computational thing. Okay. Right now, just see the geometry. So when you see the geometry, so when you will be able to see the geometry, when you are having very good idea of all these four fundamental aspects. So simply, very simple, it is column space, it would be in the codomain, in the codomain R2 here, and simply just find out what is the column space. It is linear combination of columns. Simply column space itself reflect what it would be, linear combination of columns. So how many columns you observe? There are two columns, C1 and C2, and if you try to observe further, then C2 is nothing just twice of C1. So simply you can say that column space is nothing just a scalar multiple of 1, 2. The vector 1, 2. It is just a scalar multiple of 1, 2. And here, what does it mean? So it is a scalar multiple of a single vector. So that means there is a single direction. Single vector means there is a single direction. What does it mean? It simply says that if there is only one direction, that means you are having a line. So your column space of this matrix, it is a line. And definitely here alpha is taking any value, any real value. So alpha, definitely it will take value 0 as well. So origin by default, it will come in the column space. And just find out what is the direction. Direction, simply you can get it with respect to alpha equal to 1, the simplest direction. Otherwise, direction vector happens to be a unit vector. You can normalize it through magnitude norm of this vector. So don't worry to go for that. So what would be one vector? So one vector, how you want this 1, 2, how you will get? You walk along horizontal axis 1 unit, then walk along vertical axis 2 unit. So here, this is the vector 1, 2. This is giving the direction of the column space. So in the direction, proceed forward and backward in order to get, okay, this one, this would be a line. So proper alignment would be there. So here it would coming like this way. I need everyone to visualize things like this way. Okay, it is not coming in alignment. Yes. You need to know, you have already gone through linear algebra, so you need to know whether that tutor has taught you or not, but you have to go through all those. It is requirement of linear algebra. Otherwise, the essence of linear algebra, it will be totally misunderstood. You have to go through. Yes? What you do, you can go through that. I had already, you people don't watch good video, only overview things you people watch. So go through that. There is one dedicated course, I have taken it last of last year. You can go and everything, you will see it there. Everything, every detail is there. So you can see it. So simply from there, you can talk about, this is the column space. It is very much essential to visualize. Here column space, you can visualize it. This is the column space. And what is that? Everyone is very much familiar with numbers. So in number, what it would be? It would be a linear combination of vector 1, 2. And alpha is any real number. Okay. So I need to write. This one is just introduction class. So that's why I'm coming with. So alpha is coming from R. Okay, and now next question would come, where is the row space? What would be the row space? Where, so I have already mentioned everything here. Row space, it would be there in domain. So what would be the row space? Row space, it would be, again, it is a linear, row space, simply you can say that it is linear combination of rows. So this one is the first row, this one is the second row. So first row is 1, 2, second row is 2, 4. If you try to visualize, that means if you try to visualize second row, it happens to be twice of first row. What does it mean? Row space would be just a linear combination of 1, 2, vector 1, 2. So take 1, 2, again, it would be like this way. Okay, this one is 1, 2, and you are getting a row space. That means column space of A transpose. Because you know that column of A transpose happens to be row of A. That's why we say like this way, or you can say like this way. It is row space of matrix A. What does it mean? That means it is the multiple of, scalar multiple of rows of A. And we know that second row is just twice of first row. That's why we observe there is a single direction of row space. That one is 1, 2. So this one is row space. Okay. And now I told that null space would be just perpendicular to the row space. So this, where if this one is the line with direction 1 2, what would be the null space? Null space will have it would have direction what? Perpendicular. That means it would have direction 2 minus 1 or minus 2 1. So this is the null space. Null space of this matrix here. Visualization. Again, null space of this matrix would be a line. And further, if you talk about now, my question would was what is the solution of space of this system? That if you are taking a matrix, this kind of matrix, just from the matrix itself, null space is giving idea of solution of space. So it depends upon one particular solution of, just come up with one particular solution of this one and just do translation of the null space. So if you are getting a particular solution of this one, as call it x naught, something like that, then from that perspective you can say that this solution of space would be this. It would be parallel to null space. If y equal to 0, then null space itself it becomes a solution of space of this system. But suppose y is non-zero, in that case what will happen? This you can say that suppose x naught is the particular solution of this system, then x naught plus null space, it would be your desired solution. This is the desired solution. So it is the way to visualize solution of space. Always you need to visualize solution of space. So I talked about geometry of solution of space. Rest of things you can recall it later. Okay, so I am going to discuss further about this course, what is this course and how we can proceed with. So coming to introduction to this course, and name of this course is probability and random process, and code of this course is MA203. And here my name is Dr. Lakshman Mahato. I will talk in detail about theoretical and computational and application framework of this course in detail, how we can find application of this course. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would like to discuss about motivation behind this course, why we are studying this course, what is the need. So, and afterward I will talk about what is the course goal and how we organize this course. That means what is the syllabus, what could be the course assessment, and what would be the outcome. Okay, afterward we will discuss a little bit about what is the probability. That means course is already begun. Okay, so in detail we will discuss about. So coming to motivation, I have taken a very kind of slide that in any mathematical course your ultimate aim is that you have to come up with one mathematical model, and why you are coming with mathematical model, how you are coming with, and what is the analysis and what would be the inference of that model. So that there would be four perspective of any of mathematical course in order to come up with modeling of any problem. So mathematics help to solve a problem that may come from any source. So if you want to tackle that problem, you have to come up with a mathematical model. That one is what? It is a one direct application of mathematics. So there would be four aspects. What are those aspects? So simply it would be, first would be that at hand you are having some kind of input. That the simplest thing happens to be data, what people are calling at hand. From the data, what you try to do, you try to find out what would be the involved model structure. You come up with some certain kind of model structure would be there, but we don't know what would be the best model. So in order to guess best model from the model structure, we have to estimate the parameter from the given data. And now question would come here, how we can estimate the parameter. So you have to come up with numerical, some kind of numerical method. So don't worry about this numerical method. It is not a very complicated kind of thing. It is just, you can, in math one you might have already gone through sequence. So it is just one kind of sequence, and and if you talk about more general name of sequence, then you can say that it is in one kind of iterative process. It is just, there is an iteration with each n. We, if you keep on changing n, then what is happening, that you are getting different terms. So it is just one kind of sequence. So if you are having a sequence, then we talk about convergence of that sequence. So where will that sequence will converge? So definitely it will converge to certain point. That point we are calling it optimal point or optimal solution or optimal parameter. There are various names. So simply you, so how you can carry forward, you come up with this sequence. So the numerical method is allowing to give this sequence. So just you might have already enough idea to talk about convergence of a sequence that you can borrow it from math one. Okay, so once you are having an optimal model, okay, so once you are having optimal value of parameter, then that means simply you say that you are having an optimal model. From the optimal model, you try to infer about the parameter and try to match with the real world problem. That means generate data from the learned model, optimal model, and match with the actual value what you are having. Okay, just you do some kind of validation kind of things. So that's why I told that there are four aspects that you are having some kind of input from there. You come up with the best model through some kind of optimization technique. That generally we are calling it estimation problem. How you can perform optimization technique? How you convert this into an what we call it in computational framework? You are applying some kind of numeric technique or numerical method. As that means some kind of numeric technique in you are applying in order to convert this into an iterative process. That means simply a sequence, and once from here you are getting an optimal model, and from there you try to come up with an optimal model, and afterward at last you try to infer about the model. So all about these are the four perspective of what we call it any model. So if you study any mathematics, you try to learn all those things. So how it depends upon what kind of course you are taking. So probability is really interesting. That means you will come up with a probabilistic model. Your model would be your probabilistic model. You have to estimate the parameter involved in that probabilistic model, and how you estimate that using some kind of numerical technique. Then after that you will get optimal model, and then what kind of inference you will get. That inference is totally based on probability. You are doing just probabilistic reasoning, what we call it. So a lot of probabilistic reasoning will come in order to inference, in order to infer about that model. Okay, so lot of probabilistic reasoning. So reasoning is very reasoning is one, that one is logical reasoning, another one is probabilistic reasoning. So it is very much essential to develop probabilistic reasoning. Why? Because you will see that the probabilistic reasoning is something more than common sense. Something more than common sense. It is not just like just you are applying common sense. It is something more than that. So that's where you have to be very attentive in this course in order to understand every bit of that probabilistic reasoning. How you can measure the randomness. So everywhere you will see that there is a randomness, and we can have with the after going through in deep of this course. Definitely, I am very much sure that you will come to know how to measure the randomness. And definitely, I would like to get a lot of questions from your side, and you will get answer. I will try to answer each of your question, and get question from anywhere, either from website or from Aztec Exchange. Very good source there. You can get a lot of interesting kind of question. You can get question from anywhere, and I will try to answer those things and come up with a lot of question. It would be really interesting from learning perspective. Now coming to second part of this lecture, that we'll talk about course goal and how we organize this course. So course goal, it is having just twofold course goal. So here in this course goal, you will provided with the basic understanding of probability distribution. So all about elementary probability you might have already gone through in your high school and plus two, but here you will talk about a really very good understanding of probability distribution. So everything people are calling it, that data is generated from some source, then question would be, what is the distribution of that source? What is the distribution? So you need to know, you have to be very good in probability distribution. And we will see that there is a limited number of probability distribution. Then how we can extend that class of probability distribution? Then that time we have to apply various derived approach. So there you will see derived distribution will come there. And once we are having idea of probability distribution and derived distribution from the data, how we can generate a distribution, then we will talk about random processes. That random process is it is just one kind of evolutionary process. So that means we will see that suppose just observe a stock market. So every day there is a price fluctuation. So if you talk about at each moment, then definitely there is a random variable. So in that process, simply a stock process, you can say that it is a collection of random variables. So that one is just a random process that evolves with respect to time, but with randomness. That a stock price, if you talk about it, evolves with time with randomness. Even you talk about your population evolution and you talk about a spread of disease, so always there is that one is a spread of disease that happens to be again evolutionary process, and that evolves with respect to time with certain amount of uncertainty or randomness. So randomness is coming there. So those things, if you try to model it, then random process is coming in the process to model those problems. Okay, then this is the thing that you will come up with. Okay, then after going through this course, then you will have working knowledge of various things. Working knowledge of various things you will have. That again, I should not talk about smoothness, approximation. You can talk about computation. We can talk about approximate model. We can always, if you someone is saying that with mathematical model, do we perform 100% what we call it accuracy? It is not possible. So we always perform approximation. So that's where approximation is coming. Then, in particular, if you try to further brief out about the goal, then you will have a skill about how to develop technical concept of uncertainty measurement. So it is very essential. Remember that you will have technical concept, technically how you can measure the uncertainty, then how you can measure the distribution, how you can learn the distribution. Then once you are having the idea of measuring uncertainty and distribution, then you can come up with that means definitely if you are talking data size or sample size, it would be n, and suppose the sample size go to infinity, that means from the sample you try to approximate population. That means you are just from the sample you try to talk about population. So you have to keep on increasing the sample size. That means suppose someone is saying that what is the mean height of Indian people. Okay, one question is coming there. Then if simply at your mind you will have that it is very impossible task to measure height of each and every Indian. That would be a very difficult task. So what you have to do, you have to come up with sample. So that sample must be in a very systematic way, in very random way or something like that. So random sample situation would come there, and you perform sampling, and through that sampling you come up with one estimated height of Indian people, that average height of estimated height, what we call it, and that through that we try to say that we can say that that average height of Indian people would be this estimated value. But when we say that it is estimated value, we can't say that it is actually exact value. It is very much near. Simply we can say that very much near. There is definitely some kind of certain amount of error. So it is just estimated one. And then someone will say that how you can improve it. So improve is that you keep on increasing the sample size. Keep on increasing sample size. So if you keep on increasing the sample size, what you are doing, that you are trying to approach the complete population. So that means simply you are applying large sample theory concept. So large sample theory concept, again here concept of sequence and series will come here. How to that various estimator of various estimator will come, that estimator of mean height, estimator of mean weight, estimator of mean blood pressure, mean income, average income, and various several criteria would come. And with respect to all those, through that sample we try to estimate the population mean population mean height, mean weight, those kind of things. So here, how we can do that? There would be convergence criteria would come. So that convergence would be in what? In probabilistic nature or in stochastic nature. So here, as I told that in the very first case, there is a sequence. That one is talking about deterministic convergence to a number. There would be another kind of sequence that we are calling it a stochastic sequence. So there would be a stochastic convergence of sequence. So here we will discuss about a stochastic or probabilistic convergence of sequence. So that concept would come here. So here you have to equipped with those skills, then you will come up with how various real world problem, how randomness is affecting. You will see that in most of time randomness is very good in order to bring the robustness of the system. Okay, so those things you will see a lot, and how efficiently we can solve those problem which is modeled as a random process. Okay, we need to solve those problems. So solution process also we will talk in detail. So all about these are the I talk about descriptive goal of this course, and this one is the simplest summarized goal of the course. Okay, now coming to syllabus of this course, I will discuss in module 1 elementary probability that you have already gone through in your plus 2 in high school. So that thing. So in a very brief class, we will try to cover this module 1, that elementary probability, where we will talk about probability space, sample space, events, probability, conditional probability, total probability, Bayes theorem, and independence. So these things. So I think everyone might be aware of these things. But again, I will give computational framework to each and every concept. So you will see a lot of things that you had already gone through your in plus 2. So something more you will see it here in the module 1. So it is one kind of that you are aware of that, but what you do in order to learn things in a better way, forget about those and try to come up in the very refreshing way to learn this concept. So that things I will talk about in order to see the computational feasibility of those concepts. Okay, so in module 2 we will discuss in detail about distribution. So there would be various kind of distribution. So before going to discuss about distribution, we'll discuss about random variable. Then we will come up with distribution of generally there would be two kind of random variable, discrete and continuous. And if there is a discrete random variable, then the corresponding distribution we will call it probability mass function. If there is a continuous random variable, then the value distributed through probability density function. And then once we are having discrete and continuous random variable and the corresponding distribution, then we can talk about what unification of these two concepts as a community distribution function. Then we will talk about the representation of that distribution, distributed value. The representation is coming through expectation. Then how much value of the random variable varies with respect to expectation, that we can talk about variance there. So variability of the distributed value we will talk about through variance. Then we will complicate the distribution by taking various random variable in together, so joint occurrence of various random variable. So that would be what part of multiple random variable. So here there would be joint discrete random variable, there would be joint continuous random variable, there would be mixed kind of random variable, that is one would be discrete, another would be continuous. So various situation would be there. And if you are having a joint random variable, then how you can again bring back your what we call it a single observation. That means conditioning approach will come, marginal approach will come, various approach will come. And again we will talk about Bayes theorem with respect to distribution. Then again we will talk about independency with respect to distribution. Then we will talk about function of random variables. So there that one is part of derived distribution. So derived distribution would come here. That means you are trying to enlarge your class of distribution. So that's where derived distribution is coming in module 2. So module 2 is the most important part of this course in order to understand probability. Then we will talk about large sample theory and what are the statistical inference that we have to come up with, various estimation process, and how we can infer about those things about the data. So those things we'll discuss about in detail. So how so that means from the sample how we can infer about the population. So it is all about that kind of things is coming in statistical inference. So it is also very interesting kind of things, but we'll discuss in detail again a lot. And the last part, it would be a random process. So in random process, generally we discuss about simplest one happens to be Bernoulli random process. That one is discussing whatever discussing with Bernoulli random variable, and then we will talk about Poisson random process. That means Bernoulli random process here, the index of the what we call it random process happens to be a sequence of random variable, or simply you can say that it is a collection of random variable where t is a index of the random variable. T is coming from some index set A, you can say that. So if T is a discrete in nature, then it is, so here in Poisson Bernoulli process, we will see that T would be discrete in nature. That means it would be in sequential form. That means T will take value 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of things. And after that, what you do, you can talk about Poisson random process. Like you can just take a continuous framework of T here. Poisson process will, random process will come. Then here in Bernoulli random process, Poisson random process, there would be one common thing is that there is an IID situation, independent and identically distributed situation. That means independent, simply we can say that in independent situation, that means if you take any member of the this process x1 and x2, that those would be independent to each other. If you are taking any two member of the this random process, those would be independent to each other. So there is an independency between any two member of the random process. Okay, but independency is not always feasible kind of things. That one is a very hard kind of approximation. So we have to come up with dependency among the terms of the random process. So how dependency will be introduced? We can introduce dependency through Markov process, Markov property, and hence we will have a Markov process. So Markov process will come. Then we will talk about Gaussian process. Is really very interesting from several application point of view. And Gaussian Bayesian perspective, Gaussian process is really interesting. That means you are coming with some prior belief and you want to update your belief by using Bayes' law, Bayes' theorem, Bayes' rule. Okay, you want to update. So in that case, Gaussian process is playing very important role. So all these are the part of this course, or simply you can say that an overview of syllabus of this course. Anyone is having any question till now? Am I audible? Okay. So in between, if anyone is having any doubt, any question, you can ask. You are free to ask. So all these are part of syllabus, and if also you may recall that whether I am just going fast or slower, so you can request for you can talk about my pace of that lecturing, you can talk about as well. So if you are my intention is that I try to convey things in a better way so that you people will understand it. Now we will talk about later the course assessment. So what is the, this one is also most significant part of this course in order to get a good grade. You need to understand things here. So there would be four exams in total, two quizzes would be there, two terms exams, one would be midterm, another would be end term exam. Okay. And so coming to mass distribution, 50% would be dedicated to assignment, class participation, or some kind of project would be assigned to you time by time. So that 15% is coming from that segment. Then 20% will be dedicated to quizzes. There would be two quiz 1 for 10%, quiz 2 for next 10%. So total 20%, there would be two quiz dedicated to 20%. Okay, and syllabus is already mentioned here. Even you can see all these information there in Google Classroom as well. If someone is missing this information, you can look into Google Classroom again. So now 25% it will be for midterm, and syllabus is already mentioned there. Then next 40% would be for end term exam. As per syllabus, I will maintain all these syllabus. So everything is mentioned there. Apart from this, you will be assigned with assignment and various homework, and you need to submit that within a specified time. Okay, schedule. You need to submit. So various assignment and other things would be assigned to you time by time, and deadline would be mentioned. there itself. So all these are part of course assessment. And if you talk about references, then just lecture note, what I am providing it here, that would be self-sufficient. You don't need to go further. But if someone is willing to see something further, then you can go textbook written by S.M. Ross, Sheldon Ross. It is a really interesting book. You can have e-copy of that book. Later, I think I came to know that you will also visit Institute very soon. So no worry, there are various copies there in library as well. So you can get physical copy of that book as well. Otherwise, try to get e-copy from librarian as well. He will provide that, Sagar will provide that e-copy of that S.M. Ross, A Stochastic Process. It is really interesting book. As a test, that means most of content would be there in there. It is not like that everything what I discuss would be there, but most of content would be there. Apart from that, if someone is looking for various other study, then you can go a really very interesting book by G.S. Grimmett, Probability and Random Processes. Okay, this one is a really interesting book. Third one is Pillai and Populis. This one is also a really interesting book, and it is very much famous among electronics students. If you are trying to get application from electronics background, definitely you may go through this book. Otherwise, no worry, I will come up with the example from electronics and communication itself in this course, because it is meant for ECE students. That's why I will come up with such kind of example. Okay, then there is, if you someone is very much interested in what theoretical part, then you can go for this book, Probability and Random Process by Davenport. And there is one more book by Feller. Also, you can go, that one is more theoretical, so that's why I haven't mentioned that book here. You can go all those references as well if you are willing. So try to get e-copy of this book. Whichever you find interesting, you can just proceed with that. There is no issue. But as I mentioned, that Ross is having a very broad content, so that's why I have taken that as a textbook. Okay, coming to prerequisite, as I had already shared all this information to everyone, even this slide as well. So prerequisite, whatever prerequisite would be here, I will try to explain that there itself. But sometime what is happening that people are unable to get it. So what you do, you can look into the resources provided to you or link provided to you. You can go that in order to further clear it out. Otherwise, I will try to clear as much as possible. And if you talk about matrix theory, you have to be very good in linear algebra. That as I at the beginning of this lecture, I discuss a lot about linear system. That one was the just hello world in linear algebra. What we say that you can see simply say that it is a hello world. Okay, so if you try to talk about a lot about better understand, so linear algebra, if someone is saying that what does it, is it a abstract mathematics? No, it is completely geometric in nature. It is talking about geometry of what? Geometry of vectors and matrices, vector of matter, or anything which is represented in the form of vector and matrices. You can see the geometry of that with the help of linear algebra. So the linear algebra, you can talk about it is another perspective of geometry. And what kind of geometry? It is very optimized geometry. So optimal, everything in linear algebra you will see in a very optimized framework. So it is really interesting in order to visualize each and every concept of linear algebra in order to understand the relevant concept based on linear algebra. So that's why, again, I have already mentioned the link. You can go and watch which thing you want to upgrade a lot. Just you go and watch that. Content wise, every information is mentioned there. You can have a look over that. And follow the what we call it sequential order of the content. So, and it is not like that something is mentioned first, it may come later. It is not like that. There is a proper sequencing. That means if you are studying something at first, definitely it will have implication there later. So there is a proper sequencing. It is not like that later we'll get implication in the first one. So there is a proper sequencing there in the content itself. You can see that. And apart from that, from calculus, you have to come up with gradient, idea of gradient, Taylor approximation, idea of Hessian, because those things will talk about various concept of what we call it distribution or multivariate distribution. So those things, if you are willing to understand geometry of those distribution, you have to be very good in gradient, Hessian and Taylor's approximation, that local concept what we are calling it. So that one is borrowed from calculus, that math one what we call it. And apart from that, I told that we will solve the problem there in using Python or R. Basically, I will deal with Python. So you have to come up with algorithmic programming language as well. Okay. So those things, it is very much essential to solve in computer in order to see the computational feasibility of the concept. So that's where you just you have to replace those things. I haven't taught taken any course on algorithm. You can take it from what definitely you all might have gone through some of algorithm course. Have you gone through or not? Anyone may respond. What kind of course it was? I'm talking about, have you gone through any algorithmic course or not? Like C program, that one is language. Algorithmic course, that introduction to algorithm, something like that. Okay, then you can revise it. There is a very interesting kind of source everywhere. That one is famous, that MIT open course, where you can Google it in YouTube there, and definitely you will see very interesting course from MIT or other institute as well. But MIT is the reference, that you will get everything there. So that's why I am referring that. It is not like that everything, every good thing is there, but definitely everything you will get there. So you can Google it, you will see that there are some interesting algorithmic courses there as well. So it is not part of these things, this course directly. That one is coming in indirect phrase, that in order to solve the problem in what we call it in computer. Simply, I would like to say that I am not using simulation. I am just saying that we are trying to solve the problem in computer. So that's why you have to be very good in algorithm. And also, when you are very good in algorithm, then what is the language you are just opting? So Python I will opt here, and just get some tutorial on Python itself. It would be, I think, very interesting. There is no much difference. And that one, Python is very famous kind of and very well appreciated language, so you can come up with that. Now going further to discuss, actually it is a very long class, 130 minute class, so should we take a 5 minute break? After that we will start it again. Okay, we will start again here regarding course timetable and my detail. I had already mentioned that my name is Lakshman Mahato, and the course timetable, it is already given there in the Google Classroom as well. So even you might have already received that timetable. So I will follow same thing dedicatedly. My name is Dr. Lakshman Mahato. I am working here as an assistant professor. And so if someone is willing to communicate me through mail, mail is very right way to communicate. You can communicate. There are two mails. Lakshman, that one is institute mail. Another one is lm.opl.learn. That one is my personal mail. And if someone is willing to visit my website, link is already given there. You can visit it. Now coming to that, what is probability? We'll talk about this. Simply, we are saying that this question should come to everyone. That simple question. I expect this question that from everyone. So who is opting this course? Who has already opted this course? What is probabilities? Very obvious question would come. Then one line answer, I can say that it is just talking about measure of randomness or measure of uncertainty. That means if you observe any kind of phenomena around you, except one thing, everything is having randomness. What is one? Anyone may say that what is one that one is not having randomness? Have you heard that only one thing? Somewhere I heard that motion of planets, that one is having what no randomness, it is very much certain kind of things. That's why our this universe is existing. It is just based on that what we call it, non-randomness of the motion of planet. That one, there is no randomness you observe. If there is a randomness, then definitely we will face a lot of problems. So that's why accept motion of planet, everything, any phenomena, what is occurring around us is having randomness. So how much you can see that, how much probability, importance of probability is there. If everywhere there is a randomness, simply what does it mean? Probability is coming everywhere. So that's why probability is very much essential. So we'll discuss in detail that simply probability is everywhere. It is not a good statement. Probability is everywhere except few things. We can say that. Definitely there is one kind of, if we are talking about probability is everywhere, it is not a statement, it is some kind of conjecture, we can say that, because there are some counter example. As I told that motion of planet is having counter example, there you don't observe any probabilistic kind of approach. Okay, so probability, it simply talk about the study of randomness, and randomness is of course everywhere, you will see around us. Okay, that it touches almost every area of natural science. Natural science means physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, those things are coming in natural science. And then you can talk about engineering, then you can talk about any branch of social science. So everywhere probability is coming there. So if you try to bring all these in together, people are calling this STEM in a very American way, people are calling it STEM. So probability is everywhere, simply I would like to say that, except one thing that we are talking about, motion of planets. So that one is not our job to discuss about. So our job is to discuss about where randomness is there. We have to understand that that kind of problem, and how we can measure the randomness there. So simply we can measure randomness is through probability. So simply it is as much as idea of probability you will have, then you will come across to measure the randomness. So simply what you do, you have to develop a very systematic approach to quantify the randomness. So if you say that, that's where probability is a part of mathematics, where things becomes very axiomatic in nature. That means if there is a systematic rule in order to quantify the probability, then definitely it is a part of mathematics. So if you talk about a diffusion process in physics, then what is happening, that in how diffusion occurs, how diffusion is happening. Diffusion is happening that molecules eventually move from one area of high concentration to low concentration. So if someone is saying that how it is happening, that movement from high concentration to low concentration, how it is happening, so someone may simply give answer like in a deterministic way, that due to some kind of concentration gradient. That means there is a gradient, that means some kind of flow from higher concentration area to lower concentration area. That means there is some kind of potential difference that you might have already gone through in physics. So simple answer will come like that, but it is not like that situation. Actually, that movement of the molecule, it is happening due to random movement. That means if you take any two molecules, they moves in a random way and collide to each other, and then after the collision they change the direction. So overall, if you try to see molecules within a fluid or in a liquid, then there is always a random movement. So due to that random movement, always in totality, if you observe, you will observe some kind of potential difference or some kind of concentration gradient in overall. So this one is, you can say that it is a major picture, but if you try to see the microscopic picture in microscopic way, we can say that due to that random movement of molecules, molecules moves from here to there like that. So microscopic perspective, if you try to explain, so it is coming through random movement of the molecules. Okay, and that we can explain it through Brownian motion, what we call it. So Brownian motion, again, it is a random process that we will see in last module. So we'll discuss all these detail, how that one is happening. And if someone is seeing from outer overview, then that people can model it through some kind of partial differential equation, differential equation, some kind of gradient would involve there. That, as I told that, what does it, anyone would recall, do you understand the gradient concept of gradient? What does it talk about? Anyone? What is it? Gradient is change in height. You are talking about rate of change. I am talking about gradient with respect to okay, again you are just in one dimensional function of one dimensional framework. So gradient, it is just to be denoted by this inverted triangle. Okay, gradient of f. And if you try to see what does it talk about, it is having very geometrical meaning. It is having a geometrical meaning. In one dimensional, simply you can say that it is talking about slope of the tangent to a curve or function, function of one variable. But if you go in two dimensional, it is talking about something else. It is dealing in, if you are, it is a function of two variable, then it is a vector. It is a vector quantity and it is having two component. One component we are calling it partial derivative concept would come here. A partial derivative of with f with respect to x1 first variable, and then partial derivative of f with respect to f2. So there in that case this gradient, it is defining a tangent plane. And what is unique with tangent plane? What is, what you observe unique in line and what you observe unique in plane? How you define plane? Anyone from plus two try to answer it. How you define a plane? Just two dimensional plane. How you can define a plane? Directional vector and perpendicular vector. Okay, so suppose this one is a plane. How you can define this plane? Take suppose take a, definitely your next question would be what is the frame of reference. So I am providing the frame of reference as well, because without that you can't write the equation. This one is x1, this one is x2, this one is x3. Now tell me what is the plane, how you can write equation of plane. This one is origin. Now what is your, why are taking, why we are taking perpendicular vectors? There are various questions. Yeah, very nice. Same thing. I was willing to listen. Same thing. Actually, try to find out which one is unique thing. So just try to, if you are able to see some uniqueness somewhere, then that will help to define that related concept. So what is unique here? This normal vector, it is unique. It is normal to every point in the plane. You know that. That one is concept. And if you take any point from here, like if you take, suppose one point x, call it x, and this point is the reference point, you can call it, and x naught. So easily you can write it like this way. What would be, if you are taking any vector, any point in the plane, so with respect to, now your reference is changed if you are trying to write the equation of plane. So here this normal vector, it if you try to take dot product of this n with any vector on the plane, don't take position vector. Here I am talking about reference point is itself in the plane. So you try, you are on the plane and from there you try to do dot product. So or inner product. Okay. So if you take dot product of this normal vector with any vector on the plane, then definitely normal vector would, what is meaning of normal? Means it is perpendicular. So it is perpendicular, then dot product would be zero. And if you simplify, then very simple kind of structure it will take n dot x equal to n dot x naught. And what we observe here, x naught is fixed, n dot n is fixed. So that's where this quantity is a fixed quantity. Generally we call it bias. It measure how far away from the plane which is passing through origin and parallel to this plane. So there definitely there would be a plane which would be parallel to this plane, and this would be a plane, this plane, it would be parallel to this plane which is passing through origin, and equation of this plane would be just n dot x equal to zero. So this one we are calling it linear space. So in linear algebra you might have already seen that we say that a plane or a subspace which is passing through origin, we denote it by linear space. Okay, linear space, just we call it. And the quantity which has been raised from the linear space by some translation, so this B is the translation. So okay, so you need to normalize it in a certain way. So it is a translated version of this linear space. This we are calling it affine space. So affine space may or may not pass through origin. Affine zero origin might not be in the what we call it in the plane. So it is affine space. Call it affine space. It is not containing origin. Affine space is defining like this way. N dot x. Right now in here you are free to call dot, but if you try to generalize this dot, we call it inner product equal to B. B is certain kind of bias, or simply you can say that this linear space has been translated to this affine space through this bias B. So this is the concept of writing a plane. Both are plane. This one is also plane. This one is also plane. But you know that. Can we say that? Is it a linear plane? Is it a linear system? Anyone? One? Can we say that? Is it a linear system? The affine space, is it a linear system or not? Definitely, linear space would be a linear system. What? If I talk about from the definition of linear system, and linear algebra, you might have already seen that what does linear system say that? Linear system or linear operator say that if you are having an operation, a linear transformation from one space to another space, call it U to V, then what does it say? It says that if you take any two elements from U and do linear combination of those two elements, and take two elements, x1 and x2, do linear combination, and the corresponding images would be also linear combination. That means image of linear combination would be equal to linear combination of the corresponding images. That means T of alpha time x1 plus beta time x2, sorry, we will note x2, it would be equal to alpha times T of x1 plus beta times T of x2. This is meaning of linear. I think everyone might be aware of this and might be with me regarding this. Am I correct or not? Okay, so tell me, you answered that one is linear space. Now, just are you firm on your that answer, or just try to modify it a little bit? Which one is? You mentioned that 1 and 2 both, that linear space and affine space both are linear. Are you till now, just I am asking again, trying to reconfirm it. Again, these two are linear space or something else. Again, these two are linear system or something else. This, simply, it is talking about linear system. Okay. So again, these two are linear system or not? Or one to just, you are having option. You can just modify your answer. again whether it is a space, whether it is a equation, we can talk about linear system. Linear system is a very general word. I am saying that whether this linear space is a linear system or not, or whether this affine space is a linear system or not, even you will get differential equation, whether that differential equation is a linear system or not. I can talk about various things. It is not like that. Linear system is a very generic word. So linear system is that it is following this linear transformation approach. So linear transformation, simply you can say that it is bringing a linear system. Linear transformation is equivalent to linear system. It is just a very general definition of linear system, we call it. So again, are you confirmed that one is linear system? Is it? Or only two is linear system? So one to modify. I didn't ask about dependency, or that one is a different thing. If I ask that question, it would be more complicated. Here, if you try to see one, let us apply the linear transformation or being a linear system property. So take any two. So definitely, if you are taking n dot x equal to b, that means x is variable in nature. That means there are various x which is satisfying this equation. So in order to claim whether it is a linear system or not, so we have to come up with what? Any two element, and we will apply this equation over those two elements, whether we will see satisfy it is equal to that or not. Okay. So take any two. X1. And x2. So take a linear combination of x1 and x2. X1 and x2. And we apply, because these are the solution of this system, this linear, we are calling it a system of linear equations, and we are applying, if we apply a over x1, the result would be b further. If we apply a over x2, the result would be b, sorry, it would be b, because it is in the affine space, would be. Now we are applying A over linear combination of these two. What does it give? It simply give A times alpha is a scalar. It can come out up before A times x1 plus beta times A times x2. Then what we'll have? We'll have alpha times A times x1 is what? It is b. And A times x2 is again b. So we'll have beta times b. And b is common to both. So we'll have alpha plus beta times b. Now tell me, does it satisfy the being a linear, is it a linear transformation? Does it? Definitely, unless alpha is not equal to minus beta, we can't say that it is equal to b, or alpha plus beta equal to 1. Unless alpha plus beta equal to 1, provided alpha plus beta is not equal to 1, we can't say that this would be a linear operation, linear transformation. It is unless 1 only, not minus 1. Then we see here there is an issue. But no worry, that's affine. Affine space is coming. Every affine space has been translated from a linear space. So that's way, from there we can say that it is a linear system. In a very what we call in loose way, we are saying that it is a linear system. Why? Because it is not nonlinear. It is not nonlinear. Why? It is nonlinear. Actually, it came through linear transformation. It is through the translation of a linear system. Definitely, this one is a linear system. Why? If you same thing you apply here, this operation here, definitely we will observe that a times alpha times x1 plus beta times x2, it would be equal to alpha times a times x1 plus beta times a times x2 equal to 0. So very fine, this one is a linear system. Second is applying, it is a linear system. But remember that in a very loose sense, we are saying that this one is also a linear system. Why? Because we got it through just a translation. Translation is also a linear operator. You might have already heard that if you are going through linear algebra course in module 2, there are very basic kind of linear transformation. Those are forming a very complicated linear transformation. What are those basic linear transformation? Anyone may recall? You need to see all those things in geometrical way. What are those basic linear transformation? Those are forming most of linear transformation. Anyone? Anyone would like to recall it? Yes? Yes. Loudly, may you speak it? And reflection. Scaling and are you confirmed with reflection? Simplest one is rotation, then scaling, then translation. I can write reflection in terms of any one combination of these three. Rotation, so simply I'm writing in short word, rotation, scaling, translation. These three are the fundamental linear operations, linear transformation, and any of linear transformation can be expressed in terms of these. Reflection can be expressed in the form of any of these three. Reflection is just part of this one. So through any of composition of these three, you can get reflection. So reflection, you can say that one is secondary one. Primary one, these three. Like primary colors are three. Similar to that, if you talk about that linear transformation, these are the primary linear transformation, you can say that. The rest of linear transformation, you can express in the form of these. Okay. There is one more that try to understand in the framework projection. If you understand projection, you can talk about reflection. You can, so those are very geometric in nature. You can have a look over my course again that in geometrically I have taken all those things in geometric sense, so you can have a geometrical feeling of those things. So that concept I was discussing a lot in that perspective. So here I was in diffusion. So diffusion, you can see it here. So if you take any what to call it gaseous or liquid, or simply common name of that is fluid. And then if you try to see the movement of molecules within a fluid, then it is having a very random kind of movement. So these are the random in nature. So it is not like that always direction is fixed. So it is direction is very much random. So direction totally depends upon collision. If there is a collision, definite direction automatically change. So that change in direction, it is always happening through the impact, that collision, how it is happening, that impact is. So collision itself is random in nature. So everything is random. In total, we can say that there is a random movement. So that random movement is the source of a concentration gradient when fluid is flowing from high concentration to low concentration. So don't say that due to that some kind of gradient difference, some kind of gradient or some kind of potential difference that flow is happening. It is happening due to random moment that aggregate to some kind of gradient or some kind of what we call it potential difference. It aggregate, that one is potential difference is the major that macroscopic view, and microscopic if you talk about it is a random movement of the molecules. Due to that diffusion is happening. Again, someone is saying that if diffusion is happening, then whether it is reaching some kind of saturation, definitely it will reach to saturation, that we are calling it equilibrium. At the equilibrium, again we observe the principle of uniformity. So what does it say? That simply molecules are spread, it will spread out throughout the entire space when equilibrium reached. That means there is a uniform distribution of the what movement of the molecule, uniform distribution. What does it mean? It's so simply at the equilibrium, the probability that a molecule move from one place to another place equal to the probability that a molecule move from another space to the first space. Simply I have taken here top to bottom, bottom to top, that vertical moment kind of things, movement kind of things. You can talk about if you go from one place to another, what is the probability that molecule will move from one place to another place, and the probability would be same another to first. At the equilibrium it is happening. So here once equilibrium is reaching, then you talk about probability of that movement. Okay, so everything that you observe there in diffusion process. So again, diffusion process, someone is talking about microscopic analysis, then you need to know that random process, that Brownian motion is coming in order to explain this movement of fluid particles. Okay, so here again probability is involved there, so that's why it is a what you can observe probabilistic as a probabilistic model. Now next, if you talk about probability in population evolution, again there would be probability. Like in population evolution, there are two kind of concept is there. One is mutation. So someone is saying that whether a mutation is deterministic in nature, no, it is random in nature. Then one more thing is there, natural selection. So combining these two, forcing out for population evolution. So again, you will see that probability there. Also, if you talk about spread of disease, again you will observe randomness there, or and hence simply you can observe probability there in the spread of disease. Okay, so various things will come here later. So it is already 10:30. Regarding attendance, just put your roll number there in the comment box.